Why is the sky blue? In the middle of a bright, sunny day, the sky is usually a shade of blue. Why blue and not purple, green, or orange? Well, it's all because of how the sun's light reaches Earth. If you see light from the sun hitting the ground, it probably looks like plain white light. However, that white light is made up of all the colors of the rainbow. You can actually separate and see all these colors if you shine sunlight through a specially shaped crystal called a prism. Light energy travels in waves, and different colors of light are created by different types of waves. For example, when our eyes recognize the color red, what we're actually seeing is long, stretched out light waves with peaks that are far apart. And when our eyes recognize the color blue, we're really seeing shorter, choppier light waves with peaks that are close together. The different colors of light are all determined by how stretched out the light waves are. Together, all the colors make up the spectrum of visible light, the light we can see. So why do we only see blue light when we look up into the sky on a sunny day? That blue color we see comes from sunlight hitting Earth's atmosphere, a layer of gases that gives us air to breathe and keeps the planet warm enough to live on. When sunlight reaches Earth's atmosphere, it is scattered in all directions by the gases in the air. The types of gases in Earth's atmosphere mostly scatter the shorter, choppier waves of blue light. So when we see a blue sky, we're really just seeing all of those blue light waves scattering in our atmosphere. But wait a minute, why is the sky a different color at sunset? Well, as the sun gets lower in the sky, its light is passing through more of the atmosphere to reach you. So even more of the blue light is scattered away before it gets to you. This allows more of the orange and yellow light to pass straight through the atmosphere and directly to your eyes. However, if the whole sky is glowing red, it could be due to particles of dust, pollution, or smoke in the air. These particles also scatter lots of blue light, which can lead to a very red sky. NASA's Earth observing satellites monitor how many of these particles, called aerosols, are in our air. The information from these satellites help forecasters keep an eye out on particles in the air and make sure the air is safe to breathe. In general, a blue sky is good news, and now you know why.
What is an aurora? An aurora looks like a beautiful display of lights in the sky. These are some auroras that were spotted in the sky over central Alaska. We can also see auroras from space. This is what an aurora looks like from the International Space Station. The name of an aurora changes depending on its location. If you're in the Northern Hemisphere, it is called Aurora Borealis, or Northern Lights. And if you're in the Southern Hemisphere, then it is called Aurora Australis, or Southern Lights. So, what causes these beautiful displays of lights anyway? The sun. That's right. Even though auroras are best seen at night, these colorful displays are caused by our ever-changing sun. How exactly does it work? Well, the sun is constantly sending heat and light to Earth. It also sends other kinds of energy and small electrified particles too. This is called the solar wind. Earth has a magnetic field, which protects us from most solar winds, but it also traps some of the electrified particles in the space around Earth. The sun does not always send the same amount of energy. Sometimes the sun has huge outbursts and blasts more stuff into space than the usual solar wind. These events are called solar storms. During one kind of solar storm called a coronal mass ejection, the sun burps a massive bubble of gas that pops and sends particles and energy zooming through space. When a solar storm reaches Earth, it dances with our magnetic field, and some of the energy and particles that zip around the magnetic field dive into our atmosphere near the North and South Poles. The particles then bump into gases in our atmosphere. These interactions result in displays of light in the sky, auroras. When the particles bump into oxygen in our atmosphere, the reaction makes green and red light. When the particles bump into nitrogen in our atmosphere, it makes blue and purple light. Earth is not the only planet with auroras. If a planet has an atmosphere and a magnetic field, it probably has auroras. For example, NASA spacecraft have captured amazing auroras on Jupiter and Saturn.
How much water is on Earth? Earth is special because it has so much water. It's in the ground, forms big oceans, and it's in our atmosphere. It's also in living things. Your body is made up mostly of water. Water covers 71% of Earth's surface. And almost all of it, 96.5%, is salt water. Salt water has different kinds of salt in it, but it mostly has sodium chloride, the same salt we add to our food. Just 3.5% of the water on Earth is fresh water we can drink. And most of that fresh water, 68%, is trapped in ice and glaciers. A third of the fresh water is in the ground. We call it groundwater. The last 2% of fresh water is in the rivers, lakes, and streams. A very small amount is in our atmosphere, where it exists as water vapor. That's what clouds are made of. If you took all the water on Earth and put it together, it would be a ball 860 miles wide. That's a lot of water.
How do we launch things into space? You've probably seen beautiful photos of Earth and other planets in our solar system. Those photos were often captured by spacecraft, robotic explorers doing their work far away from Earth. But how exactly do we send these spacecraft so far away? Well, it starts with a rocket. A really, really big one. Why rockets? A spacecraft and basically everything else on Earth is held down by Earth's gravity. However, a rocket burns fuel, called propellant, to push away from Earth and against gravity. This creates a force called thrust. A rocket needs enough fuel and thrust to speed up to at least 17,800 miles per hour. That's how fast you'll have to get going to fly above most of Earth's atmosphere and stay in orbit. When that happens, we have liftoff. Next, the rocket will release the spacecraft, but when that happens depends on where you're going. A spacecraft that orbits Earth is sometimes called a satellite. A satellite is released from a rocket at a specific distance from Earth. There, it keeps going around Earth in a circular path, an orbit. This happens because there is a balance between the energy the satellite picked up from the rocket, called momentum, and the pull of Earth's gravity. The balance of these two forces can keep a satellite in orbit for many years. But what happens if you want to go farther than Earth? If you're trying to get to another planet, you'll need a fast rocket to overcome Earth's gravity, and you still need to release the spacecraft from the rocket. But you'll also need to figure out the best time to leave Earth to get to that planet. Take Mars, for example. Every 2 years or so, Mars and Earth are closest together. This is the best time to go to Mars, since it will require the least amount of fuel and time to get there. And if you want to explore even farther planets like Saturn, plan carefully. For example, will your spacecraft want to encounter Mars or Jupiter on its way to Saturn? But don't worry, all the planning is worth it when you end up with a view like this one.
Our moon isn't the only moon. No matter where you are on Earth, you can usually look up into the night sky and see the moon. Our moon appears so big and bright because it's closer to Earth than any other planet or moon. But our moon isn't the only moon out there. That's right. In fact, some planets have a lot of moons. A moon is a natural object that orbits anything larger than itself. Moons come in many shapes and sizes. Our solar system has 8 planets and dozens of moons. Almost every planet has them. Mercury and Venus, the 2 planets closest to the Sun, have no moons at all. Earth, on the other hand, has one rocky and rather large moon. It's about 1/4 the size of Earth. Our moon is the only other place in our solar system where humans have set foot. What are some of the other interesting moons we know about? Well, Mars has two moons named Phobos and Deimos. They're dark and lumpy and at least 100 times smaller than Earth's moon. Jupiter has more than 70 moons. Several of them have very unusual features. For example, Ganymede is the largest known moon in our solar system. You can actually see it from Earth with just a pair of binoculars. Jupiter's moon Io is covered in volcanoes, and there's thought to be a giant saltwater ocean under the icy surface of Jupiter's moon Europa. NASA is planning a future mission to investigate Europa and its underground ocean. Saturn has more than 80 moons in total, and at least two of those are ocean moons too. They are called Titan and Enceladus. NASA's Cassini mission discovered that the underground ocean on Enceladus shoots jets of icy particles from cracks in the moon's surface and out into space. Uranus has more than 20 moons. Its larger moons, like this one named Ariel, are thought to be made up of half water ice and half rock. Scientists have discovered more than a dozen moons orbiting Neptune. Its largest moon, called Triton, has volcanoes with icy lava flows. Brr! Volcanoes, underground oceans, and icy jets? What do you think we'll discover on moons next?
Whoa! It's the middle of the day. So why is the sky getting dark? It's a solar eclipse. A solar eclipse happens when, at just the right moment, the moon passes between the sun and Earth. Sometimes the moon only blocks part of the sun's light. This is called a partial solar eclipse. Other times, the moon blocks all of the sun's light. This is called a total solar eclipse. As the moon blocks the sun's light, it casts a shadow on part of the Earth. The moon's shadow creates a trail as the Earth rotates. This trail is called the path of totality. If you want to experience darkness during an eclipse, you have to be in the path of totality. In that path, the moon completely blocks the sun's light for a few minutes. It gets so dark that it looks like nighttime during a full moon. If you don't know what's happening, it can be confusing. Animals can get confused too. But this darkness can also be kind of cool for scientists who study the sun's atmosphere, called the corona. The corona is very dim. It's usually hard to see because the sun is so much brighter. But when the moon blocks the sun's light during an eclipse, all you can see is the light from the corona. Total solar eclipses over the land, where people can see them, don't happen very often. But when they do happen, the moon gives scientists, and the rest of us, a glimpse at the corona's beautiful streams and ribbons. Thanks, moon! The solar system we call home has our sun, 8 planets, all their moons, the asteroid belt, and lots of comets. Outside Neptune's orbit is the Kuiper Belt, an almost empty ring around the sun that has icy bodies, almost all smaller than Pluto, making slow orbits around the sun. But what's beyond the Kuiper Belt? Beyond the fringes of the Kuiper Belt is the Oort cloud. Unlike the orbits of the planets and the Kuiper Belt, which are pretty flat like a disk, it's a giant spherical shell surrounding the sun, planets, and Kuiper Belt objects. Like a big bubble with thick walls around our solar system. It's made of icy pieces of space debris the sizes of mountains and sometimes larger. This is where some comets come from. The Voyager 1 spacecraft took 35 years to leave the sun's magnetic influence. It's traveling 1 million miles each day. At that speed, it will take 300 years to reach the inner layer of the Oort cloud. And then it will take 30,000 to get through it all. It's that thick. Searching for other planets like ours. Earth is the only planet we know of that has living things on it.
But could there be others? Do planets outside our solar system, called exoplanets, also have living things? We don't know, but NASA scientists are looking. They watch the starry skies for planets similar to Earth, ones that are about the same size, that are just the right distance from their star. We call this distance the habitable zone. It's where the temperature of the planet would be similar to Earth. A planet about this temperature could have liquid water on its surface. Water is necessary for life here on Earth, and it is probably necessary for life on other planets too. We don't know what living things on other planets would look like, and they might be so small they could only be seen with a microscope. So how do we find planets that could be homes for living things? We look at stars. We watch other stars closely to see planets pass in front of them. When a planet crosses in front of a star, it's called a transit. The planet blocks a small amount of light from the star. We can see a very small change in the star's brightness. This is how we can tell there could be a planet there. A NASA spacecraft called Kepler has found thousands of exoplanets this way. Future missions will be searching too. And who knows? Maybe one of those exoplanets could be a home for living things. What is a nebula? This is a nebula. It may look like a colorful work of art, but it's really a giant cloud of dust and gas in space. Nebulae are far away from Earth. We know what they look like because scientists use powerful telescopes to capture images of them. A nebula can take many different forms and shapes. But where did these stunning dust clouds come from? Some nebulae come from the gas and dust thrown out when a dying star explodes. When a massive star explodes, it's called a supernova. This is an example of what that looks like. Other nebulae are regions where new stars are beginning to form, called star nurseries. How does a nebula make stars? Well, nebulae are made of very spread out dust particles and gases, mostly hydrogen and helium. Gravity begins to pull clumps of dust and gas together inside the nebula. Then, as those clumps grow larger, their gravity gets stronger and stronger. Eventually, a clump of dust and gas gets so big that it collapses from its own gravity. This collapse causes the material at the center of the cloud to heat up, causing the beginning of a star. The closest known nebula to Earth is approximately 700 light years away. It is called the Helix Nebula. The Helix Nebula is the remnant of a dying star, like what will happen to our own sun in a few billion years. Using powerful space telescopes like NASA's Spitzer Space Telescope and Hubble Space Telescope, we've captured images of the Helix Nebula and many others. Scientists will learn more about nebulae with NASA's James Webb Space Telescope. It will be able to look through the dust to see stars forming planetary systems. Learning more about these faraway nebulae help us better understand the life cycle of stars, including our sun, the most important star to our life here on Earth.